Okay, thanks everyone for joining back up with our Social Great Lakes session. Our next speaker is going to be Katie O'Reilly, and she's going to talk about the 25 days of fishing.
Thank you, Solomon. So for those of you who were here this morning, welcome back. For those of you just joining us, welcome to Social Great Lakes. And as Solomon said, my name's Katie, and I'm going to be talking today about a successful Twitter hashtag that I did last December called 25 Days of Fishmas. So just want to get everyone kind of in the holiday spirit. We have our Yule log going, and we'll just dive right into it. So just what was 25 Days of Fishmas? It really was the result of two of my great loves, Great Lakes science and terrible, terrible fish puns. So when I was doing, you know, just my typical research, I came across this Wisconsin Sea Grant Great Lakes fish poster, and it kind of reminded me a bit of an advent calendar. So for those of you guys maybe not familiar, advent calendars are basically each day in December you can open up that day's little door and you get some kind of treat, like a chocolate or a toy. Except in this case, the advent calendar treat would be your fish species. So I decided that, you know, taking this advent calendar idea, each day in December I was going to profile a Great Lakes fish species, kind of the ecology and even some of the more social impacts of that fish. So on the very first day of Fishmas, I decided to start off with a fish that is pretty popular. It's the northern pike, and I kind of tied it into ice fishing. And each day I tried to continue a theme in terms of either it was a terrible Christmas theme joke or, you know, tied into winter somehow. So this was kind of my secular celebration of the Great Lakes and capitalizing on kind of that holiday season. And it seemed like I wasn't the only one interested in this. And so because I'm a scientist, I can't give a talk without including some kind of figure. Basically, when I started keeping records of my Twitter followers back in the summer of 2016, you know, over time it was kind of this gradual increase, pretty linear. And then where you see that kind of gap, that is December 1st. So it kind of really took off in terms of people following me and getting interested in it. But as a couple of the speakers have already mentioned today, it's not just about the numbers. What I really gained from doing 25 Days of Fishmas was kind of the engagement. Even Great Lakes Today did an article on kind of this crazy endeavor that I had cooked up, which is still kind of surreal to me, that someone would really like the idea of, you know, profiling fish species and doing terrible humor. But there's a lot more engagement with my existing followers, not just gaining, you know, more followers. And so I'm not really a communications person. I'm a graduate student studying coastal wetlands, so I don't have a communications background. But I did think that, you know, after kind of the success I saw of 25 Days of Fishmas, I wanted to identify what were the things that worked, the things that didn't work. So kind of, you know, a little self-reflection after the fact. And I was reminded of a Christmas carol, the 12 Days of Christmas, and the five golden rings. So I came up with my five rings of SciComm or science communication that I think really helped 25 Days of Fishmas be successful. So I'm going to go into detail of each of these rings, but I just wanted to, you know, point them all out. A lot of these things are themes that were talked about earlier today, and I think, you know, maybe building off that repetition will be good. And of course, they're not in the particular order that I would like, but if you do take the first initial of each of those, it does give you rings, because, you know, everyone loves acronyms. So, kind of just starting right off the bat, in terms of a narrative, what I mean by narrative is really telling a story. My goal with each day's post was to not just give you straight facts. I mean, there is definitely value in that, but I really wanted to tell a story of each species. So what I've done here is kind of just pulled out a couple of slides from a single day of 25 Days of Fishmas. to kind of walk you through what we did. So each day I would start out with that Advent calendar, the Fishmas calendar again. Each day a fish got its number, so the Northern Pike being on day one was day one, it got a one. And then if it was a native Great Lakes fish species, it got a cute little Santa hat. If it was a non-native or introduced species, like the sea lamprey, on day six, it got a Grinch. And so this was kind of a way, just every day started out with the updated Fishmas calendar, as well as an introduction to the fish that species we'd be talking about that day. And so then I would dive a little bit into the ecology. In this case, we were talking about the alewife this day, so saying that it was a native, or a species that was native to the North Atlantic, but it was not not typically found in the Great Lakes. And so, kind of going on, I talked a little bit about life history, distribution, that it was both the introduced and the native range. And then, kind of what I wanted to go into more detail about in terms of this telling a narrative was the story of how the alewives impacted the Great Lakes. So in this case, I was talking about basically how their numbers had exploded, and this was helpful tying into the lake trout story, which had been told just a couple days prior. I had profiled the lake trout and their kind of disappearance from the Great Lakes, so this harkened back to that idea and kind of tied that story together, which was cool. And then I also tried to bring in a little bit of history. So for those of you of a certain age, you may remember the alewife die-offs that would happen along some of the Great Lakes beaches, basically just huge piles of smelly fish. But that's something we don't see as often, or at least in some of these numbers. And then one of my really kind of passions towards communicating science is tying together the social science side of things in arts and humanities. And so I came across this particular mural, which was depicting the alewife die-off in Lake Michigan, and I just thought that was something really cool to share. But together, this was telling the story not just of, you know, the basic facts of an alewife, but of kind of their impact in the Great Lakes. So this is another kind of, I think, common thread through all the talks today. It's been like, what are your goals in doing science communication, whether it's traditional science communication, doing outreach, or using social media like Twitter to do your communicating? What are your goals? What is the message you want to send? Who are you targeting? Who's your audience? For me, I really knew that I just wanted to reach a wide audience. I didn't want to focus on just my fellow scientists on Twitter, but I'd like to talk and really connect with people, normal, you know, citizens of the Great Lakes who are interested in kind of Great Lakes ecology, but may not have that educational background. And so I got kind of the best of both worlds in that people, I had people from all different walks of life, all different professions joining in. I wanted to point out, every day, this individual, Eric Roberts, would make a Christmas carol talking, like, replacing the Christmas carol with fish species. It was awesome. I don't know how he was that creative to think of it all the time, but it was the coolest thing. And then at the same time, I would have other researchers sharing their particular research on that study species. So that was really cool to have, you know, connecting diverse audiences, people who may not be in science, connecting with researchers actively doing Great Lakes research. Another goal was kind of, you know, making 25 Days of Fishmas bigger than just the Great Lakes. Well, my particular, you know, interest in it was Great Lakes focus. I did inspire a couple other people to do their own 25 Days of Fishmas, where they would talk about all different types of species, marine, you know, different regions. And so it was kind of reaching these diverse audiences and then inspiring people to do their own version of it. And then finally, I think what I really liked was getting pictures of fish sent to me. I got so many pictures of people, you know, people's catches, and I think that was what was the most amazing to me was people really connected emotional on kind of an emotional level. They shared their memories. They shared, like, you know, my dad used to take me out fishing on Lake Michigan all the time. We would catch, you know, this species. And so seeing that kind of emotional connection was really important for me. So another one of my rings of science communication is definitely a subject that has been talked a lot about a lot today already, and that's the use of images, videos, and in this case it's a GIF. So some of the concepts that I tried to convey in 25 Days of Fishness weren't super easy to, you know, fit into 140 characters. For instance, this was the most popular tweet in 25 Days of Fishness, and it was displaying a male bowfin doing some parental care behavior. Basically, that cloud of black that you see are bowfin babies, bowfin juveniles. And he is the father who is swimming around, is kind of herding them and protecting them into this bowfin ball. And it's a super cool behavior. You know, a lot of people have never seen this happen before. You know, you don't spend a lot of time underwater checking out bowfin. To each his own. And so to have that image and to see that behavior actually happening is a lot more effective than just, you know, writing about it. So the fourth ring in the five golden rings of SciComm is another point that I think has been talked about quite a bit, rather ironically, I guess, is the use of repetition. So one of the most effective ways of communicating any message, whether it's science or whatever, is through repetition. And while I was doing my background on this, I came across kind of a scary stat, but on average, there are 6,000 tweets tweeted every second. So there's a really good chance that your audience is not going to catch something the first time around. To kind of get around that, that's why every day I wanted to start with the same general formats. Like, you know, we always start with the calendar, and then we would use a hashtag, the 25 Days of Fishness, to kind of keep that going. The third kind of part of repetition that I found really helpful is something that was also mentioned earlier, is the use of kind of aggregating systems like Storify, where you can track a hashtag for like a certain thing. I would collect all the 25 Days of Fishness hashtags and do like a highlight reel each week that I could then tweet out and be like, hey guys, if you missed anything, you can check it out here. And so the last of the rings is scheduling. And scheduling as a scientist can be really tough. You know, we're all really busy people, and so you want to make your time on Twitter the most effective you can. And so what I did is I actually wrote out all of my tweets ahead of time and had them scheduled to go at a certain time each day. So kind of similar to repetition, I found that tweeting, this is kind of showing how anal I might get about a few things, but I really tried to have every day at 8 a.m. I think at one point Titus even messaged me when I was a little late saying, like, you know, where's 25 Days of Fishness? But so the benefit of doing that was that people knew to expect this, you know, thread of 25 Days of Fishness starting at the same time each day, and by knowing that I had to post at a certain time, I was able to manage my time better. So I really can't take credit for this 25 Days of Fishness, even though I'm the one up here talking. It really was a community effort, and you've already met a couple of these characters if you've been hanging around this session today. Both Solomon and Titus were really, I mean, key players in this. This would not have been possible without their, you know, perspective, their knowledge, and their sharing. We had other people, you know, Jason, Donald, Eric, the Hook Lab out at Purdue. All of them provided kind of their own personal perspectives on, you know, each day's fish species, as well as they, you know, they added to the conversation and really made it more of a community effort. Which leads me into kind of my final point, and that is really what I think makes communicating science in the Great Lakes region unique, is that there is a sense of community, and I think 25 Days of Fishness was able to tap into that to a certain extent, and it showed me part of what makes the Great Lakes great, and that's the people that care about them. So I think when we're communicating Great Lakes science, it's really essential to talk, involve a lot of different groups of people, and to talk in a sense where we're, you know, connecting not only scientifically and sharing our research, but connecting emotionally and using those experiences and that knowledge to advance what we do. So with that, if I have time, I would be happy to take any questions, and if not, you can always tweet me or find me at the tweet up afterwards. So, thank you.
Yellow perch until Christmas Day, and so some people were on Christmas Day going, oh man, of course you saved yellow perch till then.
Well, that was the funny thing. So, like, I didn't really have a set, like, goal of, you know, there was no system to picking which fish species was going to go a certain day. It was really like, oh, do I have time this week to, like, spend a lot of time talking about, like, lake sturgeon? Sure, let's do that. Or like the nine-spine stickleback was, of course, on December 9th because, of course. But yeah, so that was kind of, it was no rhyme or reason. It was a personal choice.
All right,
well,
I
thank you guys.
See it again.